everybody. Welcome to a fantastic new Prog Report podcast. A couple of special guests with us. We're going to talk about the new Frost record. I'd like to welcome Jem Godfrey and John Mitchell.
Hello.
Say hello, guys. Hello. And joining me is our friend Prog Nick, all the way from South Africa.
That's Hi, not everybody. Name.
What's that?
That's not his real name. He's not, but changed it by deed poll.
No, he changed it. It's officially Prog Nick now.
Gave me that name, dude.
And Nick's been, you've been on the podcast a lot more lately, man. You've been sort of pushing your way into these. Getting rid of old Jeff Bailey.
I wasn't going to miss this one, not with one of my favorite bands.
No, for sure. I mean, if there's ever a Frost fan in our group, it is definitely Nick, so we had to have him on here. But guys, first of all, I just want to say, the new record, Day and Age, comes out in a few weeks in May. Fantastic new record. There's a first single out, Terrestrial, and I think by the time we air this, there will be a second single out as well. So hopefully everybody's checked that stuff out and pre-ordered the record and everything. But let's go ahead and talk about it a little bit. How have you guys been during this whole COVID period, and what prompted you to start the record during this, or was the plan already in place before? Jem, I'll let you get started.
Oh, all right, thank you. Yeah. It was actually, we wrote most of it before all this happened, which was actually sort of strangely sort of fortunate for us. It was we gathered together in September 2019, and we rented a sort of little cottage down in Cornwall, southwest of England. It's sort of where all of England goes on a holiday in the summer. So we went down just after the summer holiday, so it had emptied out, and we rented this cottage and we set up a little portable studio, a little sort of keyboard and a little Pro Tools ring on a laptop and guitars and stuff. And we didn't really have anything prepared, and we just, because what we've done previously is we've either gone to each other's houses to write, and we kind of, the idea we had this time was initially we wanted to go to New York to do it, but it was a bit tricky with work visas, funnily enough. So we decided Cornwall would be good. So we sort of set up down there without anything prepared, and we had an idea that we'd write a song a day, and we were there for 5 days, I think 6 days, and we wrote 5 songs. So it was a real interesting new adventure for us to do that. We wrote the framework for 5 songs. Then we went home to recover, and we re-met up again in January 2020 in a place called Dungeness, which is in East Sussex, which is right on the south coast of the UK. It's a really strange, weird, bleak place, which is right by the sea, literally right by the sea, with a big nuclear power station 200 meters over here, and it's all completely flat. And we rented this like a lifeguard watchtower sort of thing, which was a sort of 80, 90 foot high sort of concrete block that came out of the shingle. And we stayed there for 4 days, 5 days, I think it was. And we sort of then went on to write what was the majority of the rest of the album. So kind of, it was a brilliant experience, and we'll talk about it later. But, and then what happens, we got back, and then 6 weeks later, obviously everything happened and lockdown happened. So we were very lucky that we got it done before we couldn't meet up anymore. So, yeah.
Okay. So first of all, I just want to say, both to you, Jem, and to you, John, congratulations on Day and Age. I think it's a masterwork. I was going to say it's your best album since Million Town, but I'm going to say it's your best album since 13 Winters, just to be politically correct. Roy, as my editor, he knows that if there's a Frost album or a Lonely Robot album or whatever, he's going to send that review to me. He's going to ask me to do it because I'm that guy in this group. I'm a huge fan of your work, I really am. And I've done the review for Day and Age. I've still got to send it through to Roy. He hasn't seen it yet. But I kind of made the observation in that review that whenever you go to a Frost show, which, of course, I have several times, the overriding requirement is that you enjoy yourselves. That is it.
I see where you're going with this.
Right.
That's what happens. Now, a lot of people who haven't heard the album may not know what I'm talking about, but this is the overriding requirement if you're a Frost fan, as I am. I can just imagine you guys having a field day with that on stage, and more about that later. But for now, I'd just like to ask you, that notion having now manifested itself as a kind of a recurring theme on the album, sometimes ironically and through a light filter, sometimes through a darker and heavier lens, but it gets every kind of treatment. Was that the overall overriding concept going into the album? Did you approach it with that in mind, or did it just happen organically while you guys were writing?
John.
Well, I'd like the notion of, I mean, the whole thing about enjoy yourselves, you know, it's kind of like go back to sleep, or, you know, that kind of, that sort of, you know, subservient thing. You remember a guy called Bill Hicks?
Yeah.
He used the notion that gladiators, you know, the TV show Gladiators, was just a way of the government trying to stop everybody asking questions. Go back to sleep. What? Here's the gladiators. Quiet, please. Just watch the gladiators. don't pay attention. Ignore what's going. Ignore this. Watch the gladiators.
Right.
So it's kind of like actually the enjoy. It's just, you know, as a sort of slogan, it's an extension of that kind of way of thinking. As if, you know, ignore the big picture. Just get on with it. It's kind of it is a sort of big brothery kind of a slogan to make, but it is, as the time that we live in, I think it's quite pertinent right now, you know. It does. Various people actually, but it's a bit of ear candy throughout the album. There are various different people that actually have been caught on tape saying that. So it's for the listener to figure out further down the line. Yes.
Yeah, it's an upbeat record musically a little bit, but it has that kind of dark undertone through all of it, I think. And that's what maybe Nick is trying to talk about. But John, you end up singing a lot of the record more than in the past, right? I mean, how was that a deliberate thing that happened, or as you're just writing a song, you sing this one.
Yeah, well, no, it was entirely the fact that it was a matter of, you know, we recorded all the demos on Pro Tools and Jem brought his Pro Tools. We basically both, when we set up these sort of improvisational studios where we both bring equipment and we just, you know, because obviously we're in Cornwall and it's basically a farmhouse or like a little farm cottage building. And so we kind of thought, oh, we'll take that table with that lamp on it and we'll bring that over here and we'll use this and we'll put the speakers here and this and whatever. And Jem set up his computer and of course, I think I brought my Focusrite card down, my sound card with me, and I brought some speakers and he had the rig and he had the keyboard. So we kind of both brought, anyway, the bottom line is I don't really know how to use Pro Tools. So when it came to put a guide vocal down by default, I was like, you know, I'd scribbled some lyrics down. I'll just put something down just as a sort of placeholder so that we know that that's what it's going to roughly sound like. Because Jem and I have more or less, you know, pretty much got exactly the same vocal range so that we know that whoever sings it, with the other one will be able to sing it, kind of thing, because we're both sort of baritone, you know, in that range. So yeah, the idea was they would just be like, I remember when we were recording, I kept going, oh, this would be good with your voice. You should definitely sing this one here. This would be good for your voice. And then of course, I didn't think any more of it. But as time went on, Jem was like, nah, I think that one's going to stay. And I think actually a lot of the guide vocals, even though they're a bit scratchy and rough in places, quite a few of the original just guide vocals have actually made it onto the record. But yeah, no, yeah,
I think all the lead vocal on Repeat to Fade is that Dungeness guide vocal.
the slowly losing one's mind and voice guide vocal.
It's because, and this is the thing that John says, that, you know, and I totally get it. They're kind of like, they're like snapshots of your life. They're almost like sort of diary entries in the musical context. And what I loved about, and what I do love about listening back to the album, when I do, is that I can see us in that room having a laugh, you know, and it's all kind of joking, and you can kind of hear those moments. It's kind of like, it's a weird way of sort of recording a moment of your life. I mean, there's a bit in Island Life where in the background I go, woo-hoo, and that was in the room. And it's kind of like all those little things are all sort of part of the sort of audio diary of making the album. So it was kind of nice. And if you replace too many vocals, you kind of strip out that sense of wonder about, because we're writing the songs as we're singing them. So there is that sort of, that spark of us going, this is, wow, if you put that with that harmony, this is great. And if I didn't want to take too much of that out, because then it just became more sterile. So it is that sound of us kind of riffing off, writing the songs and singing about that at the moment of writing. And that, I think that's a really special and precious kind of thing.
Island Life, that's a good song. I like that one.
It's a great song.
Yeah.
And also, as Jem says, you know, it's you know, when you're recording a vocal, it is normally, I find, within the first three or four takes is where the excitement is. So if you've already done the three or four takes, the magic dust has gone. And if I try and recreate the magic in my, you know, right. like, you know, it's nice to know that the vast majority of the DNA, as it were, to sound pretentious, of the album was in those locations. You know, a lot of the guitars, I know that I didn't play a lot of those guitars again because I just didn't. we could have taken all the sharp edges off it, but that's what I think I like about the record. Is
well, yeah. That's an interesting point. There are no solos on this album.
No.
That's right, so, come to think of it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you didn't think about that until...
I didn't.
I've also featured our first ever fade. I haven't done them before either.
No.
Really?
Yes. And it's not on repeat to fade, which you would think. It's actually on the title track.
That's technically a crossfade, isn't it? So
okay. Yeah, it was, as well as anyone who knows the band, you know, we don't tend to repeat ourselves because there's no point, you know, I don't think. And so we always, with each album, we sort of think, what can we do that would make things a little bit more difficult or interesting or challenging? And the obvious thing is solos, you know, and we have been quite a solo-y band, and our sort of thought was, why this, that 32 bars, we can either just do a bit of this and, you know, okay, great, I can play. Or we could be interested, we could do something interesting. Why don't we do an arrangement? How do we make that 32 bars interesting as a band that we're all kind of invested in it? And so
I think it's important to note that you're not saying there's no musical, like, instrumental parts. It's just not a particular, like, a guitar solo. I mean, there's a lot of breaks where there's, like you're saying, there's a bunch of stuff going on musically. The title track for me it opens the album. It's been my favorite. One of my favorite songs this year to come up by anybody.
And it opens the album at 12 minutes, dude. Yeah. That's a statement.
Yeah. that's a particular Frost sound for me. It has a little bit of that Million Town kind of thing to it, where it's just a driving kind of almost the entire time, kind of really pushing the tempo. Where does a song like that develop? Is it almost a drum beat first kind of gets you going on something like that? Or how does a song like that build?
I'm trying to remember. Well, I am struggling. I tell you what I do remember about that song was that we decided it should be in patterns of three. That was the first thing we were like, because I think you had that keyboard motif, didn't you? Da, 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 two, three, four, da, 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 da. Like it. So instead of just being in straight shapes, I think I might have tried to learn it on the guitar and played it accidentally wrongly. So it was a pattern of three, and that's how that sort of that, because the whole thing is in odd cycles in a strange way, you know. But I remember us being extremely excited about that song when we'd record all day, and then we'd do a little podcast, and then we'd come back and listen to what we'd done that day, and I remember us being like goosebumps on the back of the neck, and I remember
John is the king of the bacon and egg bap. And what would happen is we'd regain consciousness in the morning, and we would convene in the central studio, and then John would set to work. I mean, a cup of coffee would appear. Thanks, mate. And then he'd be off. And then I would just sort of start the machines up, and I'd just be playing around, or have a sample or something. And then what would happen is I'd noodle with something, and then from the other room I'd hear, play that again! And so... you'd kind of, and then it would be sort of, you just develop ideas like that, and then we'd sit down and we'd kind of just play. So yeah, the day and age thing was all threes for some reason. So the whole thing about like the middle eights, all bars of three, and the riffs are bar of three, and it's all, so it kind of falls over itself, which was interesting in itself.
Yeah.
And then with what you think is just straight 4/4, I don't know, it was just a little piano riff, and then I think we had an idea, let's do the verse up a fifth, and I don't know, it's just little things you play around with, and then
No, that's great.
So speaking of it not actually being a straight 4/4 riff, you guys knew this question was coming. Let's talk drummers.
Let's talk drummers.
We have to, guys.
Go on then. Can we?
Our fans wanna know. So obviously since Craig's departure in 2019, you guys are officially a three piece now, but you got three drummers in, and wow. I mean, no less than Pat Mastelotto, no less, on two tracks, Darby Todd and Kaz Rodriguez on Day and Age and I think one other track. So firstly, my question is, who's going to be the one guy who's got to play all this stuff when you eventually go back on the road? And secondly, do you want to tell us how you got involved with these three stellar drummers and what the story of that was?
Do you want to do the story of Pat, John?
I can do the story of Pat. You're going to have to do the story of Darby. I'll fire up the mower with Pat. So basically, well, it's no secret that, you know, of people of a certain age, who grow up in the 80s, you know, people of our genre are huge fans of the band Mr. Mister, as well as obviously The Police and various other bands of that ilk and Tears for Fears. And obviously Pat Mastelotto, you know, I just remember being obsessed with, I'm particularly obsessed. I remember writing a big dissertation and sending it to Jem on WhatsApp once about why I love Welcome to the Real World.
It's so crazy because I have that vinyl from back when it came out, and I was actually listening to it a couple weeks ago for no particular reason. It's a great record.
Okay, well, it's, you know, obviously it's of its time. If you were to listen to it now, you'd think, well, you know, obviously you don't hear those kind of drum sounds anymore, and there's a lot of DX7 on there and all sorts of exciting things. But, you know, at the same time, it's an incredibly well-written and well-produced album, and the songs stand the test of time. You know, and he's got one of the best voices on the planet as well. So it helps to add to the whole sort of mixing bowl of why we love that album. But anyway, we were on the cruise to the edge, obviously, and it was, we just played. And I remember I'd spent far too much time on the top deck, and I was sunbathing with next to Craig and chatting, and I just forgot to put sun cream. I got very badly sunburned, and my legs were like lobsters. And I was like, I remember we came off stage, and my legs were literally throbbing, like, you know that thing when you get sunburned, like a dubstep concert, right in my legs. And and then I got into the elevator, and then Pat Mastelotto comes in. He goes, hi, you guys, you're in Frost, aren't you? I said, yes. He goes, you guys were amazing. You guys are really, really good. I said, oh, thank you. And I just got out. And I said, that's great. No, I've got to go. And I just, elevator doors open, and off I walked. And then I thought, that was Pat Mastelotto. I should have said more. I should have gone and bought him a drink. But my legs are on fire. So, yeah, there was a lot of regret there. And, of course, I thought, well, the idea sort of went into my head that actually he likes. And I went and told Jem very excitedly. And Jem was like, oh, this is remarkably good news. And then, of course, it came times to do the recording. And I think, Jem dropped him an email. I think we got the email from the label. And I think Jem dropped him an email. And he said something like, well, I'm just a tired old rock and roll drummer, but yeah, I'll do it. Something charming and sort of self-deprecatory like that. But yeah, it was, so he did do it. Yes, he's on two of the tracks on the album.
That's great. That's awesome.
Derby was, I currently live in a town called Tunbridge Wells, which is in Kent, and down the hill from where I live, there's a sort of old Victorian, it's a Victorian spa town, and there's an area called the Pantiles, which is basically this sort of, it's like it was in the 19th century. It's got this, you know, colonnade, and it's all very lovely, and there's a bandstand in the middle. Anyway, so in the summer, what they do is they put these jazz gigs on outside. Well, they did, obviously, they don't do it at the moment. And and it was every Wednesday night, and I never went to them because you think, well, you know, jazz schmazz. But one particular night, I was meeting a friend of mine for a drink, so we just went for a pint, and there's pubs and bars and all kinds of things down there. Anyway, so we went down, and I didn't know this thing was happening. And suddenly I was like, oh wow, lots of people everywhere. So we nip in to this bar on this lovely open space. It's a beautiful evening. And there was a jazz band on, and there was just this little sort of like, they weren't trad, they had a keyboard player, and it was sort of, they were doing sort of slightly fusiony kind of things. It was interesting, and we were chatting away, and then I just was sort of became more and more aware of this sort of drummer doing this stuff, and I was like, hang on a minute. And my friend Mitchell, I go, yeah, hang on a minute. And eventually I thought, I do know what, I have to get my phone out of the phone. I thought, John's got to see this. And this bloke was just unbelievable. I was thinking, this is with Tunbridge Wells. Who are you? So anyway, the gig finished. I went back, I went home and I said, John, look at this. So he looked at me and, oh, wow, okay. That's interesting. So the next day I emailed Darby. He was one of those, I don't think he has any more, but there was a point where he had his email address on his website, Schoolboy Error. And so I went, hello, my name's Jamie, don't know me. And I'm in this band called Frost. We're doing an album. Do you fancy drumming on it? And he went, I know who you are. We were on Cruise to the Edge together. And I was in Headspace. I went, really? Oh, okay, that's nice. So we sort of struck up a friendship. And so, yeah, it was kind of, he was such a talent that night. But it's just, you'd have that instinct. You think, he's brilliant, you know, because he wasn't. What I like about Darby's playing is he's showy in small bursts because he understands the importance of song structure, you know. So it's kind of like he's really, really creative rhythmically, but he's also quite restrained when he plays for the song. You know, he used to be in a band called The Darkness and sort of other pop bands and stuff. So he knows about structure and musicality and stuff. So yeah, it was just a complete fluke that he's on the album, but it was just, you know, it was a brilliant, and again, this whole album's been about those sorts of happy accidents, you know, it kind of, and we sort of want to roll with the flow with that.
And Kev Rodriguez, of course, is a kind of a drummer's drummer.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, very, very prominent on YouTube clinics, that kind of thing. But I got to say, those fills that he does in the title track, the short, sharp, innovative fills, they really are, very tasty. That's really the only word for it. Was he specifically chosen for that reason on that particular track, or how did that come about?
It kind of was, yeah. I mean, he was, because he does lots of Zildjian videos and stuff, and he, as you say, a drummer. He's on YouTube all over the place, and he writes tracks that other drummers use to solo to at drum clinics and shows and stuff, which is a new, I've not heard of this as a concept before. But I've been watching other, obviously, because we were looking at drummers, and I looked at lots of drummers online. And every now and repeatedly they'd go, oh, this is a Kaz Rodriguez track we're playing. I'm thinking, okay, fine, that's good. And then another one would go, oh, this is a Kaz Rodriguez. Who's Kaz Rodriguez? And so I took it. And there's this guy, and not only is he writing stuff, but he's also this amazing, amazing drummer. So he was immediately interesting because he has that musicality. And a lot of his songs have chords that I call frost chords in them. They've got all these little like, sort of strange bass inversions. And I was thinking, this is musically really interesting. So again, I got in touch with him and said, you know, hello, do you fancy playing on a few tracks? And, you know, Kaz being the gentleman that he is, he said, yeah, absolutely. Sounds brilliant. Fun.
Very cool that worked out. I mean, it adds a cool element to the album, the kind of changing the style and the sounds and everything. And it's maybe you're onto something there for future records. Who knows?
Going to be Ringo next time.
That's right. all right. So, well, again, the record comes out. Is it May 14th, that's right, May 14th, a couple of singles out, check it out. We're going to move on to our topic for this podcast. So we wanted to do sort of make an ultimate pop/prog album. So our topic here is we're each going to pick songs that are proggy, but not by the traditional prog people that we know, more pop acts that maybe try to stretch themselves and try something interesting. And so we're each going to pick three, and we'll go in turn and see what we come up with here and debate on what's good or bad. All right.
Before we go any further, would I be able to visit the Gentlemen's Ablutions there?
Please.
Sorry about
Enjoy
this.
Yourself.
Enjoy yourself.
Oh,
come on. Oh,
right on.
Right on.
Right
on.
Right itself. Right itself.
Jem, why don't we let you go first with your first pick, and then we'll go John, and then Nick, and then myself, and then we'll go around again. Does that work?
Okay. I'm going to start with a song called Atlantic by a band called Keane. Keane were
love Keane. Keane are great.
Keane Keen and Great. They had three very good albums, and then I think it's sort of a slight personnel implosion. But this is from the second album. It's the opening track of the second album. Yeah. And what I loved about it was the song. I think the album's called "It's Under the Iron Sea," isn't it? And I think it kind of just conjures up. It's very cinematic, that opening track, and it conjures up a kind of grey North Sea kind of vista. And what I love about it is it builds all the way through it as a sort of sense of dread, and then about halfway through, completely changes into this kind of Selena string synth, sort of much more romantic, kind of sort of wistful ending. And it's completely unlike anything else they ever did. And it's a brilliant vocal performance from Tom Chaplin. It's full of keyboards and it's properly proggy, I think.
You know what? That's a great choice. I was thinking of Keane. I'm a big fan. I have all their albums. And I was thinking, do they have something that fits for this actually? And I think you picked the right one from their catalog for it that actually does work. Because it is an odd opening track for a band like that.
Yeah.
And it is kind of weird for them. It's really good. Nick, are you familiar with that?
Yeah, I am. It's a great song.
Yeah. Their debut album, by the way, I don't know if you agree, but I think it's one of the great albums of like that whole early 2000s, that whole thing. It's just one of the best albums from that whole period.
Also, there was like you had The Feeling and 12 Stops from Home, which is another album from around that time, which was equally, I thought, very good in terms of. Yeah, they had that sort of. They were slightly softer and, but nonetheless, it was from around that time.
I think I was in. I used to have to travel to like Germany and stuff like that for some other work that I was doing back. On previous lifetime, and there wasn't much TV, but you always get like an MTV channel on in the hotel room, and I would just put that on and discover what was out, and that's where I first heard "Somewhere Only We Know," and I was like, "Whoa, this is amazing!"
Their lead instrument was a Yamaha CP80 piano, you know, which is beloved of Peter Gabriel and Tony Banks, and you know, it's got that kind of it. They were much cleverer than people gave them credit for, I think.
Yeah. For real, yep. Songwriters. Great choice. All right, John, what's your pick?
I'm going to start with Head Over Heels by Tears for Fears. And that's basically because it starts in the Lydian mode, which is very oft used in the world of prog. They're using those notes. It's basically in the Lydian mode. And also, when there's like a counter guitar motif that comes in, and it suddenly sounds very much like Steve Hackett's walked into the room. And I just think, you know, the modulations between, you know, it's just very cleverly put together song. And it's not, you know, it's not proggy in the terms of it's got odd time signatures or anything. But, you know, as in terms of the hooks, it sounds quite sort of tangential. It's kind of odd for a pop song. So that's going to be my sort of...
Could include the second half... The law, but that other song that attaches
I knew you
to
were going
to
go there. It's a cheap
that's
shot.
That's the proggy thing, right?
That's the proggy thing. The bit where they, you know, yeah, you could argue that the, you know, but I just think the whole motif of it, and it kind of it just sounds a little bit like you would associate with what I mean. I know I'm talking about the regressive nature of prog here, not the. You know,
yeah,
the,
I mean, we're all big Tears for Fears fans for sure, and I mean, I think they're like. For this kind of topic, they're almost the band, I think.
They're a shoo-in, aren't they? Really?
Right, that works for this completely.
Yeah, it does. I just like the song, and even if it wasn't, I derailed the concept already, probably. But it's
not at all. No, I mean,
not at all.
I'm
it's
sure
like
this
song, and also just a little name drop here. We spent a week in Fort Wayne in Sweetwater, where we were rehearsing for when we went to do the Cruise to the Edge. Thing the last time we went there, and we were rehearsing because we didn't have it's a very good point actually. Would have been Nick DeVigilio. That was when we did it with Nick DeVigilio,
who played drums for Tears for Fears, right?
Yeah, that's it's all making sense now, isn't it? And of course, and we had a guy called Nigel Dick who was filming us throughout the week, and I didn't know who he was until suddenly somebody said, I think Nathan said to us, have you seen this guy's CV? And he kind of, what's Nigel Dick ever filmed? And because it's like, you know, Guns N' Roses. I think he did like November Rain or something, and then Head Over Heels for Tears for Fears, and then we're not, and all of a sudden we were like, we're not worthy, you know.
Wow,
and,
yeah.
We never used any of the footage anywhere, and we even like recorded a little gig that we did in a dive bar across town, and it's very strange. All this stuff got recorded, and it's just floating out there in the ether somewhere. I think we might have got the stems from it or something. I'm not sure. I can't remember, but it was just an interesting thing to. He had a lot of stories to tell us once we. Once we found him out, he was telling us all about Britney Spears, and because he did Baby One More Time for Britney.
Wow, he's done a lot of big videos. That's amazing.
And he's quite cool. An unassuming chap, you know.
Very cool. All right, so I guess I'll go. Oh no, Nick, you're next.
Okay, so for me, it's all about the ability to write and play more complex chops. That's kind of and many pop acts can do that. And some have taken advantage of the ability and produced proggy sounding songs, but others don't. I do want to mention at this point with John on board here, I do want to say that I could have picked an It Bites song for every single one of these, because there is this misconception out there that It Bites, both in its Francis Dunnery incarnation and its John Mitchell incarnation, there's this kind of perception that they were a pop band, right? Because of Calling All the Heroes, which is so far from the truth. The opposite is actually true. I mean, even Calling All the Heroes is proggy to its core. So in my opinion, It Bites are a prog band who were perceived to be a pop band. So I'm not going to mention them again.
I think they were three bands over three albums personally. And then they become a sort of pastiche when the lesser spotted It Bites, as I would call it in my version, was just like a pastiche of all three trying to be one thing. But no, I mean, I think the first album's like Duran Duran or something. Second one's like Genesis, and third one's like some rock band trying to be from LA, you know, with a gruff voice, which kind of, you know, it's kind of slightly musically schizophrenic in their sort of outlook. But, you know, my favorite bands always are, you know, like King's X changed a lot over the years, as did Jellyfish. They when they did Spilt Milk, that was a bit more sort of way deep into the Beach Boys from the first album, you know. It's kind of, yeah, but no, point taken. But yeah, let's not play It Bites, eh?
Okay, so for that reason, I'm not going to mention It Bites again, even though I could have.
Ever.
Times, I'm going to go with a little bit of left field here. I'm going to go with a band that was more a rock band than a pop band, but they were indeed a hit-making machine. And that's the band Boston. Their song from their first album, which is kind of cheating because it's two in one, but these songs are always played together, are Foreplay and It's Been Such a Long Time from the 1978 debut album. This is Tom Scholz showing his proggier side, I think, certainly with that instrumental intro. It's very classically oriented. It's got hectic chops all over it. And interestingly, this is apparently the first song that he ever wrote, apparently in 1969. Which for me shows his true musical identity. It was recorded on two-track in his basement, and Rolling Stone magazine described the song as a perfect marriage of Led Zeppelin and Yes. So there you have it. Foreplay, It's Been Such a Long Time by Boston.
Okay, I shall have to check that out. I'm unaware of the man's work, apart from the big hit, which of course Kurt Cobain famously did at I saw him live. I think it was Reading Festival in 93 or 94. And he went, jing a jing, jing jing, jing a jing, jing jing, jing jing, jing jing. Oh, I see.
Man, I never put that together. And that's amazing.
It's exactly the same riff.
You have changed that song for me forever.
Boston did the happy version. That's the difference.
You're right. Oh, my God. Good for you. That was amazing.
There we go.
Yes, we learned something today. All right, so I'm going to go with mine. All right, I'm going to go with Sting and from the Soul Cages album, which to me is his prog record. All right, thumbs up. And I'm going to go the first track, which is Island of Souls.
Oh, yes. Yes. Why didn't I think of that?
I'm just
that's how these things go, John.
The thing for me was I wasn't the biggest Police fan, because I'm not a big fan of I like some of the songs.
I'm looking for a red card. I'm looking for a red card. Yeah,
I like some of the songs, but at the time I never got into the Police as much. But when he started doing his solo stuff, I got completely hooked, and because it's way more adventurous, and Island of Souls is just a total prog record. And I just love the long songs, the weird chords, the whole thing. It's just, it's so epic. And Island of Souls is just the most epic song on that whole thing.
Slightly Geordie accent in places as well. It's my favorite Sting album. You know, they've done some stuff. I mean, I kind of, at one point, I think when he did Desert Rose, I was kind of out, you know. It was good, but I was a bit like, nah.
Yeah, the albums that sort of came later all had sort of like two or three good songs, but they weren't, you know, he started to sort of write a few things that were a bit weird, but no, but even the song, the Soul Cages, that brings back a part of Island of Souls into it. It kind of so he's doing recurring themes. And
I think
that's
when he was still doing really, really intelligent arrangements. And, you know, like the thing about Sting is he is like Gershaw. He's very good at going from, you know, through all chords, and you don't hear it when it comes back around. It's like, wow, how did you do that? You know, he's very, very clever like that.
Yeah.
Sorry.
7 days on it. Which one was that?
That was
Seven Days was Ten Summoners.
Ten Summoners Tales.
Wow, that came after, I think, was the one album right after, I think.
Big hit in the UK, 5-4. I mean, that's fair play.
That is fair play.
Seven Days is amazing. That whole, I mean, the drumming on that and just the lyrics, the whole thing. Sting's lyrics are just the best.
I think the idea from that Perfect Tense off that Kino album, I was like, I'm having some of that as well.
Englishman in New York, right?
All right, good. So round one is in the books. All right, Jem, what's your second choice?
My second choice, they're slightly more eclectic, this one, from arguably one of the greatest pop songwriters of all time, Paul McCartney. And he, I think it was 1980. I don't quite know what the circumstances for why he did it, but he released Paul McCartney 2, which was, I think he played and recorded everything on it himself.
Yeah, I think so.
And there's a track on it called Secret Friend, which is kind of, it's sort of, he just suddenly, for no particular reason, I mean, on the album that you had Coming Up, which was a sort of classic kind of woo-woo sort of thing going on.
Right.
And then he does this track called Secret Friend, which is 10 minutes and 31 seconds long, for a start. It's based upon what I think is some sort of, like an ARP synthesizer. It's a sequence riff that just basically keeps going up, like a semitone up, then down a fourth, then up a fifth, and he's singing this sort of very long, protracted sort of vocal line through a megaphone, and it invoked, like, you know, that kind of that new wave era, King Crimson and Talking Heads. He just suddenly went massively kind of new wave sort of prog, and it's really kind of, I mean, it doesn't really evolve much, but it's like a 10-minute kind of experiment, a sonic experiment with the synthesizer moving around, this high string line, him doing all this singing stuff, and I think there's Mellotron on it, and it just that came out of nowhere, you know, Paul McCartney, and he never did it again either. It was just this kind of strange, he had a track on it called Temporary Secretary and all these kind of really strange.
That song is wacky.
Yeah, you know, I only heard this album quite recently because I don't know how I ended up there, but I remember playing it thinking, what is he doing? This is brilliant. And he just basically, he just went out, he went off on one. And it kind of, you know, for a Beatle to do that, I think was brilliant. It was kind of, it's just an experimental piece of work. I think
that's an underappreciated album. He actually played, I saw him in concert and he's doing all the Beatles hits, you know, the 3-hour show and the whole thing. And he throws in Temporary Secretary in that show. Oh, it's wild.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
If you think about even like, so I know you're gonna laugh at me because it's you know, it's Wings, but if you listen, well, I'm not going to defend that. That's, I sound like Alan Partridge, but if you listen to like Live and Let Die, you know, those, the whole arrangement of that is bizarre. You know, it starts out as a sort of easy like Sunday morning, then it goes into the riff, and you get those really sort of strange, odd, angular chords that, really weird, and then it goes into a reggae section. I mean, the guy, you know.
Actually, that Live and Let Die would have been a good one to say. Actually, that's a brilliant idea.
I almost went Uncle Albert, which I also think is sort of like a real trippy kind of nut kind of prog song. But he's a genius at writing these songs that have like three different complete sections. He did, you know, Band on the Run is like that. He has a whole bunch of those. But he's the greatest ever. So, you know.
Friend. As I said, Secret Life, it's called Secret Friend.
Yeah. Well, great choice. Awesome. All right, John, you're up.
Okay, I'm going to go with, and this is, you might find the strangest thing, Who Are You by The Who, right? which you might think is just a completely ordinary song. But right in the middle of all of that, all these and bonkers modulations and strange. I don't honestly know what goes on inside Pete Townsend's mind. It's like just an ordinary pop song, but straight in the middle of it, it kind of goes into these really kind of, it's, you know, like really kind of sort of oriental sounding motifs and things. And it's, it, I mean, I know, you know, with the Holy Grail is to find something which, you know, is hiding in plain sight, and that really isn't. But as a pop song, it's pretty out there when you think about the whole middle section.
Yeah.
You know, and he does it quite a lot. As if you listen to I Can See for Miles, there's like, it's a similar thing. As soon as we get to the middle section, Pete just loses his mind. You know, it's remarkable what he does with just a straight song, you know. And I do, you know, I love The Who. They're my favourite band of all time.
Apart Are they? From
the Police. No, number two, actually, sorry. I've just downgraded the Police by accident. Didn't mean to do that. I put the Police
oh,
on.
Oh, so the Police were your favorite, and that's why you were giving me the red card. I got you.
Yeah, it all makes sense. It's okay, but you know, you're supposed to come to Sting through the Police. Not you're not supposed to do the reverse Genesis, and you know.
Precisely.
Correct. Yeah, no, I quite like Invisible Touch, but now I quite like The Down Lies Down.
That's funny. All right, Nick, your next one.
Okay, so I'm going to go with a very obvious big pop duo, Daryl Hall and John Oates. Now, I don't know if you know much about Daryl Hall, but you know, even though he's had massive pop success, he's an incredible musician. And in my opinion, he's a bit of a progger in disguise. In fact, not so much in disguise. I mean, his links to Robert Fripp are fairly well known. So I'm going to go with a song from one of their lesser known albums, the third album they did in 1974 called War Babies. And the song is called Screaming Through December. Now, I know you guys probably haven't heard this song, but the album was produced by Todd Rundgren and various members of Todd's band Utopia performed on this thing. So that played a part in the progginess. But truly, it was the songwriting on the song. It was Daryl's love of King Crimson and David Bowie, which clearly shines through on the song. It starts off with Daryl giving it everything vocally, and he's an incredible vocalist, amazing singer. So that's saying something that Daryl's giving it everything. And then all of a sudden, halfway through the song, two extremely proggy breaks in what I think is seven time happens with a guitar of superimposed, I think in six, over this seven time keyboard break. As prog as it gets, prog to its absolute core. So I'm going to say "Screaming Through the Beaches" by Daryl Hall.
No, you're right. I mean, you showed it to me a month or so ago, and I was like, "Damn, I'd never heard Hall & Oates do anything like this." Because I
proggy, right? Proggy.
It is. It really is. It's right? Surprising.
Yeah.
It's like seven, 8 minutes or something, too, right? Like.
Yeah. It's full on prog, man.
That's wild.
So cool. I encourage the listeners to give it a listen.
I'm going to go Dave Matthews Band and Rapunzel from their third album, Before These Crowded Streets, from 98, which is crazy. I can't believe that's already that old. I don't know. Are you guys familiar with Dave Matthews too much at all or to what extent?
He comes from Johannesburg, dude.
I mean, right. Well, the drumming's always been amazing because with Carter Bruford playing, I mean, it's always insane. But on that particular track and on that album, really, they went from all the pop hits of the prior record to writing long 8-minute songs with extra parts and crazy time signatures. And Rapunzel is probably the peak of that. It's all over the place, crazy playing. The drumming is insane. It is absolutely as prog as a band like that could get. And of course, it didn't sell as well, which is why they went in another direction after that and tried to write more hits. So, you know, that's what happens. But I'm a big Dave Matthews fan, and he's written a bunch of great material. But this album is really, if you like prog and you always thought Dave Matthews was just an acoustic kind of jam band, this album is not that. It's really, really, really good. So Rapunzel from Dave Matthews.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Nice.
Okay, Jem, your third and final choice.
Third and final. This is it's a very well-renowned female songwriting duo who have had a very, very long career and first came to prominence as the guitarist and keyboard player for Prince, Wendy and Lisa.
Yeah.
And what was always interesting about them to me was that sort of in that the Purple Rain era, you could hear them doing their thing on Prince's stuff. If you listen to the song Take Me With You from that album, for example, well, there's all these little strange string lines that are kind of in a relative key to there's all this stuff going on. It's not anything to do with the song. And then right at the end of Purple Rain itself, there's this amazing 4-3 minute string thing that just pedals in E that Lisa Common wrote. And it's this massive prog string section at the beginning. And then obviously they went off and did their own thing. And from their most recent album, they went on to do lots of soundtracks for TV programs. Heroes they did, which was a big TV show over here. Anyway, their last album was called White Flags and Winter Chimneys, and it's the final track on it called Sweet Sweet. It's 8 minutes, 42 seconds long. And basically what it is this incredible atmospheric, incredibly emotional atmospheric piece of music, which it sort of starts off with just a piano and vocal, really sort of incredibly beautifully sung and played, really vulnerable vocal, and it kind of swells and there's lots of beautiful chords. And then it just builds from that into this amazing kind of end of the album as it is. It's reprising themes that were on the first track of the album and all these different bits and pieces. The mellotron appears, there's loads of mellotron choir and the drums, the tempo changes. It's just the most amazing cinematic piece of music. It still kind of makes me all the hairs on my arms go up because it's so vulnerable but so progressive at the same time. And not a lot of prog bands can do emotional, I think. You know, you can't get that thing that makes you go, oh, you know, it's an extraordinary piece of work, an incredible bit of composition. I'm a massive, massive fan of it.
I've heard some of their stuff over the years, but I'm not familiar with that one, but I would want to check that out. That sounds really good. Yeah. Actually, I didn't even think of Prince for this podcast.
Well, I mean, that's a known goal, but, isn't it? Prince has got plenty of.
I mean, it would totally make sense, but it just completely skated by me. But nice one, man. All right, John, your third one.
Well, I'm not very good at this game, obviously. I'll tell you what I was going to go for, and then what I've ended up with. I was going to go for NOFX, The Decline, because they wrote the Decline is an EP, which is a very long pop punk thing, which changes, you know. And I thought, well, it's like a prog song because it goes through different movements. It's like theme and variation. I thought, no one's going to have heard of NOFX, and if they have, they probably will turn their nose up at it. But I shouldn't be swayed by popular opinion. I know. And I thought, no, I'm going to park that. Then I was going to go Public Image and Rise because it's just so bonkers. And I thought, yeah, but then it's not really proggy, is it? But it is quite unusual for. You know, it's kind of, you've got the whole sort of, you know, it kind of modulates, you know, harmonically in the background, but then Johnny Rotten's just shouting throughout. So I thought, no. And then I was going to go Andreas Johnson and Glorious, who's a Swedish guy, had a big pop.
Oh, yes. I know.
Remember that? Richard. And I was going to go for that because, again, that's got such, it sounds like something that Marillion could have quite easily nailed at some point in time. Then I thought, no, I'm not going to do any of that. I'm going to, I'm going to go Aha, Hunting High and Low. Not Hunting High and Low, sorry. Yes, Hunting High and Low.
That's perfect.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it was going to be, it was either going to be that or The Sun Always Shines on TV. Because both of those songs are far too epic to be pop songs, really. They're right. So wimpy.
That whole intro to that song.
Yeah, those are both great choices.
Such strange modulation. Like it goes from A minor, the way it goes, needs sort of all diminished chords, and it goes up to D minor. And then it just... It's just such a beautiful, you know, and that whole album actually, you know, all anybody could see was Morten Harkett's cheekbones at the time. And, you know, when that album, considering this was way before that Uber production, it was all done on analog tape and all the sequences recorded onto tape. And, you know, all the vocals are like very pure and he doesn't always sing necessarily completely in key, but he had a really sort of operatic voice. And when he went for a high note, you really knew about it. And you know, obviously over the years, his singing style's changed. He sings a lot more softly now. But back then, that whole that wasn't actually their first album. But you know, Hunting High and Low, the album, that was one of the first LPs I really. My sister gave it to me, and then she started playing Move Closer by whatever her name was, and she played that on repeat about 1600 times, and she said, I've had enough of a-ha, listen to this. So I had my Amstrad thing next door, like trying to, you know, play havoc with her. Move closer. No, we shall listen to a-ha now. And so there was a big war going on between, our bedrooms were next to each other, and I was winning at one point with a-ha. But that album is one of my sort of, they kind of, for me, they invented what I lovingly call the Scando sound, you know, which we didn't really know about before, which is a really bleak kind of sort of empty kind of sound, which later bands like, you know, Haim and Sergio Ross have sort of adopted, and Car Park North. It's all nine chords and really very sort of atmospheric, and there's lots of reverb, and it's kind of, you know, and that's kind of wanted to steal a load of that for Lonely Robots, if I'm being perfectly honest.
No, a hot fit with this perfectly. I think that's great. Can you believe all these years Take On Me is still like just the biggest song? Who would have thought that after like a bazillion years?
Well, yeah. I mean, obviously, you listen to the original record, it's a bit twee, isn't it? It's a little bit... It's like my first drum kit or something. But, you know, it's been reimagined millions of times by lots of different people. And there are some, you know, you know, they are remarkable writers, I think. I think they're much, in the canon of pop, they've been much misrepresented, I feel.
For sure.
And what a vocalist, wow.
Yeah, he's
a great singer.
What cheekbones as well, going back to 1982.
That's another podcast. All right, Nick, your last choice.
Oh, what to do? Could have gone Gino Vannelli, Joe Jackson, Steely Dan, The Police. How can we leave off The Police? I think this band deserves to be mentioned twice, just because they really were proggers at heart, I think. So I'm going to go with Tears for Fears again, and this time Bad Man's Song. I mean, it's a fairly obvious choice, but I think it deserves to be here. The studio version featured Manu Cachet on drums and Pino Palladino on bass. It's pop, but it's prog. The live version, which was recorded at Nebworth, is almost overwhelming in a different way. Aletta Adams, fantastic vocalist. It's a duet with Roland. And it just goes to so many places that I think it deserves to be mentioned here. So I'm going to go with Tears for Fears, Bad Man's Song from 1989's The Seeds of Love.
Yeah. I mean, it's worth pointing out as well that, you know, they as a band, they kind of coexisted at the same time in that whole Bath scene. You know, you had a lot of people, not literally in a bath, in the town, near the town of Bath, in, you know, where Pitt. And so, like, you know, you had a lot of cross-pollination between, like, the people, you know, down there. And, you know, and I love the fact that they found Aletta Adams in a bar, and she was singing in a hotel lobby, you know, on the piano and just singing. I mean, it's an amazing story that they kind of lifted her up, and they took her under her wing. Right.
No, amazing album, amazing song. Yeah. Good choice. And like we said, Tears for Fears makes a lot of sense for this one. So that really works.
Yeah.
My last choice. God, I'm really stuck between two. But all right. I'm going to go with the band My Chemical Romance.
Oh, my goodness.
And Welcome to the Black Parade.
Black Parade.
From their Black Parade album. Damn, my voice is a mess. Yeah. John, why don't you talk about it? You seem familiar with the song.
Well, I've always loved My Chemical Romance. what I remember about that is when that came out, and I remember I was working with John Beck at the time, and he said he absolutely adored them, and they had all the Jimi Hendrix jackets on, and they were really conceptual, and he said, what a great song, man, you know, and he really got into it. And I think, you know, but I also remember him being very enthusiastic about Kaiser Chiefs when they did I Predict a Riot, because they had that sort of whole yobbo sort of who. Anyway, I'm going off topic. Yeah, no, My Chemical Romance. Yeah, that was... Yeah, Welcome to the Black Parade. Really, really good song. And of course, it changes key about six times, doesn't it? It keeps rising, goes up a tone every time. Yeah,
And it has a lot of, they're really channeling Bohemian Rhapsody and Queen and all, you know, the a million background vocals and orchestration. And
didn't Panic at the Disco actually do Bohemian Rhapsody live once? They, I mean, all that, because they were of that same sort of ilk, I think.
I think they were they might have been label mates, I'm not sure, but that's a great album as well, a real concept record and really good.
Yeah, no, I agree. And you know, whilst all those, you know, again, it's always that thing that, you know, like I say, you know, back in the day, everybody sort of ruled against prog and goes, oh, prog is evil, look, they're dinosaurs. And then of course, you know, Johnny Lydon, you know, goes and gets Steve Vai on his record. I mean, I think secretly, and he loves Van de Graaff as well, so you know, I think everybody's a secret sort of prog head, really.
Yeah,
you know,
every band at some point tries to get, they're gonna go, all right, now we'll write long songs and get an orchestra. Everybody tries that at least once.
And all that rock.
That didn't work. Quick, back to the yes.
That's right. It didn't work. Let's go back to
the Hurt Factory.
Gentlemen, just wanted to say congratulations on the latest masterwork. Thank you for all the music over the years. Thank you. We appreciate you.
Welcome.
I haven't got enough. I've got nothing.
Jem Godfrey and John Mitchell Frost. The new album Day and Age will be out on May 14th, if I'm correct, on
correct,
all formats. Go out, buy it. You need this record. Congratulations, guys, and best of luck with the new release.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
All right. Thanks, guys. This was fun. Right. Thank you.
Thank you, mate.
All right, guys. Bye, guys. Bye. Bye.